I'm going to introduce Kerry Pinkowski, who's the executive director of the Bank of America Chicago Marathon, and then he will introduce his fellow speakers. Kerry Pinkowski has served as the executive race director of the Bank of America Chicago Marathon since 1990. During his tenure, he has grown the event into one of the largest marathons in the world, with 37,459 finishers representing all 50 states, more than 100 countries in 2015. And any of you who've ever been out to participate or to watch the runners or just try to get around the city of Chicago on Marathon Sunday, know it's like being in the United Nations with all the different people from different countries and all of their race colors. It's just fantastic, even if you can't get where you want to go. As executive race director, Kerry's responsible for all facets of the race. He designs the course, which features 29 distinct Chicago neighborhoods, and is world-renowned for its speed, resulting in 3 world records. And he coordinates event logistics with dozens of city, state, and federal agencies. The marathon has a tremendous economic impact on our city, more than $250 million each year. And since 2002, the event's charity program has raised more than $150 million for local, national, and global causes. In 2006, Pinkowski, along with his race director colleagues in Boston, London, Berlin, and New York City, formed the World Marathon Majors. It now includes Tokyo. It's a 6-race series that awards an annual $1 million prize purse to the world's top male and female marathon runners. Kerry's received many awards, including the Illinois Track and Cross Country Coaches Association Meritorious Service to the Youth of Illinois Award. Boy, that's a lot. Woo! That one needs some editing. The Chicago Area Runners Association Gold Medal Award for Event Production, the Marathon Photo Road Race Management Race Director of the Year Award, presented by the Running Times Magazine, the Best Race Director Award, the National Distance Running Hall of Fame's Fred Lebo Award, Google to find out who Fred is or was, and the USA Track and Field's Alan Steinfeld Award for Lifetime Achievement in Men's Long Distance Running. Despite all of that, he's a member of the Indiana Athletic Hall of Fame and the Running USA Hall of Champions. And you'll have to ask Kerry if the fact that he's kind of shiny on top of his head helps him as a runner or not. Kerry Pinkowski, come up here.
You have some water. I have some water. Wow. Thank you very much. It is such a pleasure to be here. I mean, obviously, the speakers that have been part of the Chicago Club, such a distinguished group, and to be part of that and to be invited to talk about the Bank of America Chicago Marathon is a real, real honor. I see so many of our friends here. We have some of our media partners from NBC5, our hotel partners, our hospitality side, some of our charity partners are here. So thank you so much for coming out and supporting this morning. One of the things I want to do is talk about the marathon a little bit, but really showcase our charity program. And we've got some of our partners that can also speak, but we've made some great strides with that program. Last year, in 2015, Race Morning, we raised $18.7 million, which was a record for us. And it's amazing when I started, thank you, doctor, for pointing out I started in 1990. People got their calculators out there, and they can figure out how long I've been around here. But we really had no charity program at all. So the idea that we started out was very, 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 very small expectations and goals, and it's grown exponentially, which is amazing. And the charity program is something we're really proud of. I also, really quickly, we're talking about the Chicago Marathon. I just want to acknowledge the director of OEMC, Alicia Tate Nadeau, who's here. She is OEMC is is the city agency that coordinates all of the partners we have, agencies in the city, also is the liaison with our federal partners, and year in and year out has been an amazing partner in dedication to this being a safe and secure event. The hardworking people there in the coordination, not only here in Chicago with the agencies, but the federal agencies that plays a role. So thank you very much for that. How did I get involved in running? I think we should talk about that a little bit. I'm from Hammond, Indiana. Is there anybody from Northwest Indiana here? All right, there you go. All right, there we go, Diane, okay. And I had an English teacher who convinced me to come out and run, kind of baited me into doing it. I grew up, you know, in traditional sports, baseball, basketball, all of that. And he talked me to come out and run with the cross country team. I thought it'd be good to get in shape for basketball and baseball. And I found that I truly enjoyed that and decided to join the cross country team. And we had some great success. Fortunate that I was recruited by some colleges. One of those is Villanova University. And I decided to attend Villanova University to compete on the track and cross country team. And it was probably the best decision that I made because I had made some great friends from the New York area. My teammates were from Long Island, Brooklyn, Queens, and it was just a wonderful experience. Baltimore, Washington, D.C. Villanova traditionally at that time didn't recruit kids from the Midwest, so I was kind of the first kid from Indiana to show up in Philadelphia at Villanova. And one morning, one of the guys from Brooklyn, a teammate of mine, said, Let's go up to New York and watch the New York City Marathon. Okay, so you have to remember, this is in the late 70s. Again, I'm aging myself. We took the train from Philadelphia up to New York, and out we went to Manhattan along the river on the 59th Street Bridge. And at that point in my life, my perspective of athletics was competitive. I was a competitive runner. My teammates that were with me were a competitive runner. And this is the era of Bill Rogers and Alberto Salazar and Frank Shorter. So we watched the elite athletes come over the bridge and Greta Weitz. My teammates take off across Manhattan, across the park to the finish line. And I found myself staying there. And I was absolutely captivated by the people that followed these world-class athletes. And I was amazed at the fact that there were people in this race that didn't look like runners, that had absolutely no chance of winning or placing, or absolutely no chance of finishing within hours of the champions. And that just stuck with me. And as I watched these people, I stayed there for hours, I realized that this was such more than the front end piece of it, that it really was about individual achievement and a celebration of humanity and that individual achievement. And that stuck in the back of my mind. I later met the great Fred Lebow. We mentioned the award that I had. He was the impresario of the New York City Marathon. An amazing guy. All of us that produce the World Marathon Majors owe him a debt of gratitude. He was the guy that thought of the urban marathon, to bring the event to the neighborhoods, to introduce running and activity in an urban environment. And he was such a sharing and giving guy that he told me about where he thought running was going to be and how important it was. And I was fortunate enough not only to compete in some of the events that the New York Roadrunners produced, but also I became friends with him. In my early years as a race director, he was a wonderful mentor. Unfortunately, we lost him way too soon. So the fact that I went to Villanova and connected with some teammates of mine and watched the New York City Marathon in the late 70s, and then returning to Chicago, I just felt we could have an event that rivaled any marathon in the world. And it's been, someone said to me the other day, I'm a 27-year overnight success. It has been a long journey. There's so many people in this room that have played a role in that success, and that's what this event is about. It's about teamwork and partnership, the community coming together. It's so unique to any other event, because if you think about the participants, this year, we're celebrating our 39th run. We're going to have 40,000 people that are coming to Chicago that are from all 50 states, okay, 130 countries. And a lot of the majority of these people have never been to Chicago before. And they're coming to Chicago to discover themselves and discover this community. And for people that have never been to Chicago before, what better way to discover this city than to see these neighborhoods? we'll talk a little bit, and I'll talk about the numbers about how big this thing is and the international reach and all this stuff. But people are here are coming because of the local flavor, the local contribution, the local partnerships. And that's the thing that's so rewarding to me is the fact that it is a big event, and it is big business. And we have sponsorships in the corporate community. But when you drill down to this, it truly is a celebration of humanity and personal achievement. And we're going to talk with our charity partners in just a couple of minutes and see the great work that they're doing. So that's what drives me. And as we get 10 days out from this great event and the 39th running, that's the energy that takes over. The calls that we get in our office, the people, the excitement, all of the pieces that go into this is amazing. So let's maybe just take a temperature check. How many people are running? How many of you guys are running in the marathon? Let's see. Okay. How many people know somebody that's running in the marathon? There you go. All right. There's power in numbers. It wasn't always like that. I know Jim Sheehan is here. He was the director of special events when I first started. Believe me, the marathon was thought as some kind of extreme pain in the butt that, you know, people running down the street. So you can see how far we've come. I used to take calls where people were complaining that they couldn't get across the street to get the newspaper. Now they call and say there's a pothole or there's some glass on the street. You got to clean that up. So my nephew's coming or my aunt's coming or my cousin's coming. We got to make sure that everything goes together. But really, for us, there are three pillars to this event. Obviously, the social piece. The fact that we have 40,000 people coming to Chicago from all over the world. And you know what I did? I just grabbed this, and bear with me for just a second. When you talk about 130 countries, I pulled this up this morning when I was coming down. I'm just going to give an example where they come from. Angola, Argentina, Australia, Belgium, Brazil. We have 490 people coming from Brazil to run in the Chicago Marathon. Canada, there's 1,538 people coming from Canada to run the Chicago Marathon. Chile, there's 140 people coming from Chile. China, 550 people are coming from China. Colombia, there's 230 people coming from Colombia. Costa Rica, El Salvador, Finland, Honduras, Guatemala, Israel, the Philippines, Nigeria, New Zealand, Mexico. Our largest international participation, 1,960 people are coming to run in the marathon. So it truly is a global social movement. And they're going to be going through some of these great neighborhoods, and they're going to discover the fabric of this great community. People running healthy and active lifestyle, not just here. Those of you that live along the lakefront can see it. The training groups, the people that are running. If you live in the suburbs on the paths, it is a movement, and it's amazing, and it will culminate next Sunday. Of our participants, from when I started to now, 47% of our participants are women, 53% men. So the women are catching up to the men. We have 12,507 of the 40,000 marathon runners, our first time marathon runners. This is our first marathon, so that's a big portion that we have first time marathon runners. So you're going to be in company there about, you know. A fourth of our participants are first-time marathon runners. The economic piece, when we talk about all these people coming to the city, they're staying in hotels, and they're traveling with their friends and their family members. When I talk about 550 people from China, there's over 1,500 people in that group that are traveling with them. They're staying with our friends at the Palmer House or the Hilton, and they're shopping and doing things and discovering the neighborhoods. It drives the economic engine of the event. $277 million derived from the 2015 event. We commissioned an economic impact. That information was released earlier this week. So the economic piece and the philanthropic piece, I just mentioned that $18.7 million last year, over $150 million since 2002. And some of those charities, as you hear, have a local focus, national and international focus. Pro athletes, this is a great year. What a tradition up front we have with the international athletes. We just had the Rio Olympics. I know that's upsetting to some people because we feel we should have had them in Chicago, but the history of the Bank of America Chicago Marathon, going back to Joan Samuelson, Chicago Marathon champion, Olympic champion, Dina Castor, Chicago champion, Olympic bronze medalist, Constantina Dita from Romania, Chicago champion, Olympic champion, Sammy Wanjiro from Kenya, two-time Chicago Marathon champion, Olympic champion. And just recently in Rio, our 2014 champion from Kenya, Eliud Kipchoge, won the gold medal. And Jemima Sumgong, who was second in 2014, won the gold medal. So that tradition will continue. We have four former champions up front some amazing athletes from Japan and other countries around the world, so that elite athlete tradition continues. Another element that I'm so proud of and fortunate are our wheelchair athletes. Our wheelchair athletes here in the state of Illinois are the best in the world. We have an athlete named Tatiana McFadden who will be attempting to win her, is it her seventh Chicago Marathon? She's won six Chicago Marathons. She's won, and no one else has ever won three, she's won six. We just saw her in the Paralympic Games. The team that comes from the University of Illinois, it's so rewarding to me when I go to London or Tokyo and I see that Illini vest winning these international events. And they will all be here in force. And in support from Abbott, our local, obviously iconic company here in Chicago, supports our wheelchair division. So that tradition will continue. And celebrities, Christy Turlington. Obviously, everyone knows Christy Turlington. She's running this year in the Chicago Marathon. She's running for Every Mother Counts, which is her charity. And Rob Riggle, those of you that watch the Fox pregame or Saturday Night Live or any of the some of his movies, he's running this year, and he's going to support Team Salute, which is one of our local charities. So the event is for me very rewarding. I have the privilege of being the race director and being able to talk and speak about it, but there's literally hundreds and hundreds of people that play active roles behind the scenes that contribute to this event. And you'll see that on Sunday, October 9th, as the city comes together to celebrate the 39th running of the Bank of America Chicago Marathon. And we're going to have a great day. First time, how many people are volunteering? Let me go back and see that. We have some volunteers here. I know some of our group. And this is a question I always, how many people got stuck in traffic are going to get stuck? Okay. Sorry, I don't like that. There's no hands, so there's nobody there. No one that got stuck in traffic. Well, what I would like to do now is invite some of our, Good. Is invite one of our charity partners here. They're our local partner. This individual is a former vice president of marketing and communications for McDonald's Corporation, where he worked for more than 20 years. He has served as a communications and strategic planning for Ronald McDonald House and other charities. He spends most of his time now recruiting and helping and managing Team RMHC, and he helps us out and does some consulting for the Bank of America Chicago Marathon. Charles is an Olympic distance triathlete and a marathon runner, having completed the Bank of America Chicago Marathon four times. He's also competed in the Marine Corps Marathon and the New York City Marathon. And he is the driver of the relationship that we have with Ronald McDonald House Charities. And let's have a nice warm applause for Charles Rubin. Obviously, I didn't go to rehearsal this morning, so. The next individual I'd like to bring up ran his first Bank of America Chicago Marathon in 2007 with Team World Vision. The following year, he invited over 50 people from the church he was pastor at to help him join and raise funds for World Vision and a Clean Water Initiative. Over the next several years, Steve continued running the Chicago Marathon and took on some bigger challenges. This is amazing, including Ultra Marathon in South Africa. In 2013, he took a leave of absence from his job at the Willow Community Church to take on an incredible challenge. He ran from Los Angeles to New York, averaging 30 miles a day for 5 days for 5 months, and raised over $500,000 for Team World Vision. After completing his journey, he joined the staff of World Vision, and he's now directing their endurance platform and will be leading the group this year. World Vision this year has 1,630 runners that are raising money for their charity and initiative. So let's have a nice warm welcome for Steve Spear. And to kind of set the tone for the discussion, I thought we would, we're going to show a video. Those of you that ran last year, this is an excellent reflection on what took place last year. Those first-time marathon runners in the room, it'll give you a great opportunity to see the sights and sounds of this wonderful event as you prepare in 10 days to run the Bank of America Chicago Marathon. We'll be right back. Well, those first time you're there, there you have it. That's what you have to look forward to. Now, we saw a beautiful, nice day, and I don't want to put any pressure on anyone, but we have Alicia Roman here from NBC5, who is the meteorologist and will be working on our and she has a streak going since she's been in Chicago and working on the marathon. We've had great weather, so let's all knock on wood and see if we can do that. But I do call her directly and bug her for weather updates. Well, what I like to do is kind of shift it to discussion to RMHC and get some perspective, and obviously talk open up to the group this morning. But Charles Rubner, RMHC, how does your charity, McDonald's, and the Chicago Marathon, how does that fit together, and what are the results of that?
Sure. In terms of Ronald McDonald House Charities, the first thing I'd say is that the partnership between the Bank of America Chicago Marathon and Ronald McDonald House Charities, it's really an ideal marriage. So many of the families that we serve are experiencing their own marathon, we say, as they deal with weeks and sometimes months of in-hospital and outpatient treatment for the children in their family. So they're running their own marathon, and we use that analogy often in terms of helping our fundraising. The mission, the charity was started 30 years ago in memory of Ray Kroc, the founder of McDonald's Corporation. Oh my gosh. I apologize. Rule number one.
Turn off your cell. Did you notice how he looked at me? Is that you? No. That's okay. We'll let it go. It's usually me where it goes off. Yeah.
My apologies. The mission of the charity for more than 30 years has been to create and support programs that directly improve the health and well-being of children. Over the years, because of the prominence of the Ronald McDonald House program, what that's really evolved into is a shorthand mission of keeping families close. In the medical community, that's called a family-centered healthcare, in keeping families close. For children, the truth is, the simple truth is, that children heal better when their parents are close. And if you're a parent, and if you're a parent in this room, if your son or daughter ever gets sick, your number one concern is achieving the best health care possible. For the families we serve, a lot of times that health care is hundreds or thousands of miles away. And what Ronald McDonald House makes possible is for those parents to get the best possible treatment for their child. They stay at a Ronald McDonald House. We have 359 houses now in 43 countries. Most of the houses ask for a contribution of $5 or $10 a night. And if a family can't afford that and there's rooms available, we never turn anybody away. Imagine somebody being treated at Lurie here in the city and having to stay in a hotel for 2 months. It's not possible. So that's really what is the magic of Ronald McDonald House Charities. We'll talk more about different programs, but the cornerstone program of the charity is certainly Ronald McDonald House. In terms of the team RMHC and the Bank of America Chicago Marathon, this is a beautiful story. So the team started 10 years ago. 2006, there was a gentleman working for McDonald's Corporation, Bob Marshall, who became captain of Team RMHC. Bob was vice president of U.S. restaurant operations, and he was a runner. 2006, he got a bunch of his friends from the supply chain, and he had 32 runners, and they raised $39,000 running to raise money for Ronald McDonald House Charities. He crossed the finish line, and he saw a Dunkin' Donuts truck. And he said, that ain't going to happen again. And so the very next year, 2007, McDonald's Corporation became a sponsor of the Bank of America Chicago Marathon, and Ronald McDonald House Charities became an official partner charity of the marathon. That was 2006. In 2015, that 32 runners and $39,000 came up to 803 runners, and we raised $1,183,000. Thank you. And in this 6 years, in the 10 years that we've run the program, we've now raised over $6 million. In terms of my story, we were, Steve and I and Carrie and Alex were talking before this and said, and Charles, tell them your story. I said, Carrie, I don't have a story. Okay, so Steve's got a great story. So my story, I guess, is I worked for McDonald's Corporation. I started in 1974. I was very blessed. I was successful at it, was able to retire in 1995. And then I started showing up at Ronald McDonald House Charities offices. They're in Oak Brook along with McDonald's Corporation. And started doing some work for RMHC in 2008, 2009. I helped the person that was managing the team for 2 years, and she eventually got married and left the charity. So I had dinner with a gentleman who's in the room, Tim Kennedy, who was director of the development team for RMHC. And he said, Charles, any chance you want to be involved more? So I managed the team for 2010, 2011, and 2012 for 3 years of good growth years. By 2012, it turned into a real... It was a job, and I said, Tim, I want to work. I just don't want a job right now. And I hope everybody gets to that point. So there's been other people. Katie Marchetti's in the room, manages the team now. So I guess if there is a story, that's it. My career was with McDonald's. I helped sell a lot of hamburgers. I was very blessed. It was successful there. But nothing is as fulfilling or as rewarding as helping families and raising money with the Bank of America Chicago Marathon and what we make possible. We serve a lot of dinners. You carry your team, Chicago Event Management, serves dinner at the Ronald McDowell House here at Lurie. And I was serving dinner one night as part of the team RMHC, and it was a couple not speaking very much English. And I got close to them, and I started to talk to them. The husband explained that they didn't speak much English, but they were very grateful. I explained who I was and what I was doing. And I'll never forget this, because it's one of these moments, and the mother just stood up and gave me a hug. She couldn't speak. That's why I do this now, and why I have so much of me invested in the charity program. So wow. A little bit about RMHC and Team RMHC, and Steve's got a story.
Well, Steve Spear from World Vision. I mean, why don't we talk about the starting with World Vision a few years ago and where we are now and a little about the program and how it intersects with the Bank of America Chicago Marathon.
Yeah, thanks so much, Carrie. Thanks again. Thanks for your story. Thanks for hearing that again. That was very moving. And seeing the video, I'm ready to run right now. Let's just do this. It's so amazing. And Charles, you're one awesome human being. So World Vision, some of you may know or have heard of World Vision. We're the largest Christian humanitarian organization in the world. We work with children, families, and communities in 100 different countries, and we tackle the issues of poverty and injustice. That's what we do. We have 44,000 employees worldwide, like I said, in 100 different countries. And Team World Vision is a portion of World Vision, and we are all about raising money, motivating people, inspiring people to run marathons and half marathons here in Chicago, and to raise money for clean water in Africa. If you know anything about the developing world, the most basic building block that you can do to bring hope in a community is the provision of clean water. The number one preventable cause of death in the world is the lack of clean drinking water. And so when we're talking to people, we always tell them about two facts. Number one preventable cause of death in the world, lack of clean drinking water. Number one killer in the United States, heart disease. You can do one activity and peel back both. And so run a marathon. And that's the message we've been giving to people in Chicago, around the Chicagoland area, since we began in 2006. And the partnership with the charity program is an amazing one. The Bank of America Chicago Marathon is epic. And we started in 2006. We had 90 runners that ran. And as Carrie said, this year we'll have over 1,600 runners run the Chicago Marathon. But it started with 90. In 2006, and Michael Chitwood, who's our national director, began it that year. Josh Folkers, who's with me this morning, Josh actually leads our Chicago Marathon team, all 1,600 of them. I have an opportunity just to work with him and a lot of our other staff around the United States and other marathons, but Josh leads our efforts here. And in 2006, one of my buddies ran the Chicago Marathon. He was a friend, and he ran it, and the day after the Chicago Marathon in 2006, he called me and he said, "Hey, Steve, you should run the Chicago Marathon with me next year in 2007. And I had a two-letter answer for him, N-O. I said, absolutely not. And he said, oh, you should do it. It's a charity program. I said, God bless the charity program. I'll write checks. He said, it's with World Vision. I said, I'll write a check to World Vision, but I do not need to run a marathon. For 4 months, he pestered me, and for 4 months, I told him no. Until I got one of those little soft voices that some of us get every now and then. And I was being kind of softly spoken into my ear saying, hey, Steve, all the time, you're always inviting people. I was a pastor at the time. Always inviting people into the unknown. Always inviting people to take a step out of their comfort zone. And this little soft voice says, so why are you so unwilling to train for and run the Chicago Marathon? And I didn't have a good response. So in that moment, I felt like I was supposed to do it. So I had four goals for my 2007 Chicago Marathon. Goal number one, because I told my buddy how much I hated to run. So goal number one was to hate running less every time I ran. Goal two was to train well enough to make it to the starting line. Goal three was to finish before we closed the course. My finishing time, that was the hot year, 2007. You can look it up. My finishing time, 5:59:59. 1/100th of a second under 6 hours. And then my fourth goal was to raise $1,000 for clean water in Africa. And one of the things that motivated me to run was, and since that time, you know, Charles mentions about being blessed. I've been a very fortunate individual to have raised, you know, over $500,000 for Team World Vision. But one of the things that kind of captivated me and captivates each of our runners that run with us is what we call the $50 rule. $50 is all it takes to bring clean drinking water to one person at last. $50 is all it takes. And it's an incredible thing. I've been to the field several times, and I've met the communities and met the children and the families and that we bring clean water to, not just hundreds or thousands, but tens of thousands of people. And when you meet one little girl who formerly would have spent much of her day, eight-year-old girl, spent much of her day walking up to 4 miles per day, carrying a jug of contaminated water that will lead to the death of half the kids in her community under the age of five, you meet one of those little girls one time. And you're kind of going, if all it takes is me to run a few miles to take away the few miles that she and right now 653 million people on the planet go for dirty contaminated water, if I can run a few miles to take away a few miles from somebody like that, I'll do it. I'm in. So I was going, all right, if I can bring clean water my first year, 20 people, great. And that's what we inspire people to do. How many people can you bring clean water to? 10, 20, 50? 100, 1,000? Is it possible for a person to raise 5 or 10 or 20,000? Yes, it is. Because we see this celebration of humanity through a marathon, and you see people doing things you never thought were possible. Why can't we do this? So it's a perfect, I think you use it, it's a perfect marriage. The charity program, I love the charity program because you have people that are so motivated by a cause and a passion that grips them. And we just have the opportunity to grip, a bunch of people that will run for some kids in Africa. So it's pretty cool.
Awesome. Well, let's see if there's any. Yeah. Wonderful. We have some questions.
Let's hope.
Yes.
Okay. If there are any questions, would you just hold them up? We'll have a member of our staff come around, Jack Thornton back there, and pick them up. Ah, Jack, there's one over there on the far side of the room. And while we're waiting for Jack to pick those up, first of all, thank you, gentlemen. Thank you, Steve, Charles, Carrie. I noticed your cell phone went off, Charles. I'm just curious.
Oh, you did.
I'm just curious. Because the only marathon that I've ever competed in is the Special Olympics Polar Plunge. Oh. And I broke that 6-hour record running from the warming house into the water, back to the warming house, back to my home where I spent the afternoon with a good friend, Johnny Walker, and warmed up. Your cell phone went off. Are there runners who carry a cell phone when they're running in a marathon?
And there are, and it's discouraged on two levels. One, from a safety standpoint, you want to be concentrating on your race and the people around you and the people in front of you, so that you don't trip if there's something on the course or if there's somebody crowding next to you. So from a safety standpoint, it's not a good idea. There's a bigger reason not to do it, and that's the crowd. There's 1,700,000 people that are spectators on the course, Enjoy that. Take that all in. You trained for 20 weeks to running the marathon. The hardest part of running the Chicago Marathon is not running the Chicago Marathon. The hardest part of running a marathon is training to run a marathon. You trained for 20 weeks for this day, for this moment. Enjoy it. It is thrilling. 29 neighborhoods, 1,700,000 people. This and the city that you see, if you're from outside of Chicago, you see the city, you see all these neighborhoods. And so you miss that if you're if you have an earbud in. If you do run, just put an earbud in one ear so you are conscious of the people around you in the crowd. So
I like that about a compromise. One earbud, you hear the crowd on one side, yeah. Britney Spears on the other side.
Great.
Bruce Springsteen.
Good. This is from Connor Kelly, who works, I think, for the city of Chicago. Gentlemen, what's your favorite part of Marathon Day? Want to start with Kerry?
For me, obviously, Marathon Day is the implementation and the operations and of the event. So it's where I go to work and where our team goes to work. I think for me, the what I enjoy is the days before. Obviously, our expo is at McCormick Place. This is where you get to meet and interact with so many people, the people that we talked about, and you get to see the chemistry of all of our participants and that interaction and that excitement. So for me personally, the day before, the days leading up to it are probably the most rewarding, and then probably Sunday night about 10:30 at night is probably another good time.
After you've seen Alicia give you that great
yes.
Sunny day, exactly. Thank you. Steve, how about for you?
I would say probably the thing that sticks out the most is we have a big team gathering, you know, super early in the morning. The sun hasn't even come up yet. And this year we'll have right around 1,600 people packed into a tent in Charity Village. And it's payday. Marathon is payday. That's when you get to celebrate all that's been done, your training that you've been doing, the fundraising that's been done. And so this year we're at like $1.3 million right now for this year's marathon. Our fundraising, we're aiming for two. We still have got like how many days left, Josh? We got like 10 days and we're bearing down. We've got a lot of big things. But it's that morning and there's excitement, especially with people that are brand new. There's this excitement and nervousness and there's a sense of expectancy. And then they're just looking out over the city as the sun rises and you see the beautiful skyline and you're kind of going, oh man, this is awesome. It's just an awesome sight.
Great. Chuck, how about
for,
you?
Yeah, for Team RMHC, I think for our runners as well as the people on staff, the moment is when they come back to the tent, they finish the 26.2 miles. We have a tent, as does Team World Vision. We have a red carpet that people come in on. We have stanchions. We have volunteers giving them high fives. Ronald McDonald is there to give a high five. And it's that moment. They have done something. So many of these runners have done something they never thought possible. They ran 26.2 miles. You saw in the video, when people turn onto Columbus Drive from Roosevelt, if you're a first-time runner or a second-time runner or a 10th-time, you're crying that you saw that line, the finish.
Yeah.
There is not a prettier sight
yes.
than seeing that banner that says finish in all bold face. And so bring them back to the tent and congratulating them and seeing the smile on their faces and the conversation about the charity, about having helped so many charities. You talk about the clean water. So for $1,100,000 dollars that we raised, the average cost we figure for a night at the Ronald McDonald House is $80 a night. So our team last year raised enough money to have families stay for 15,000 nights at Ronald McDonald House. And it's a conversation like that. We have big pictures, a real extreme close-up of young children's faces in the tent and around our tent in the Charity Village. And that's the moment.
Very, very heartwarming and meaningful. Here we have a question. Beth Bracco from Blue Plate. Beth, where are you?
She's in the back.
Way in the back, okay.
The back.
Great catering company, way in the back, okay. What's the goal to increase the charity program for the marathon? Do you have a dollar goal?
Wow, that's a good question. I think in many ways we're talking about the work that we've done.
But for me, as the organizer and working with this group, obviously World Vision, RMHC, we have 179 charities that are participating this year. So some of them are very small, some of them have a local focus. Obviously, see Special Olympics is here and some of the other charities that are in the room. What we look at, and Charles and I have talked about this, and Steve and I have talked about this, 40,000 participants on Sunday, 10,000 raised $18.7 million. There's another 30,000 participants that we need to engage, that we need to activate and get these stories to them. We need to get the culture and let them know what the good work is. So there's, have we scratched the surface? I think we have. If we can move the number to 14,000 or 15,000 or 20,000 of the 40,000, then exponentially the number will go up. But it's something that we talked about at our coordinator meeting, and for us, I think the sky is the limit, and I think we can continue. I talked about 25 years ago, maybe we could raise $10,000, you know, maybe we could raise $100,000. And then I said, I think we can raise $1 million. They told me I was crazy. Well, last year we raised $18.7 million.
Well, so obviously you're very sane here. Okay, I have three more questions. Janet, with no last name. Janet, do we have more than one Janet here? No, she's right over there, good. What are three things, that set the Chicago Marathon apart from the others, other than we're one of the greatest cities in the world?
Well, that's part of it. I'll give Steve one, and then Charles, and then I'll have my one element.
Well, I mean, definitely having just the beauty of Chicago. I mean, obviously we're biased, and you'd mentioned this. I mean, we're biased toward the city of Chicago, but the beauty of the landscape, the beauty of the skyline, the lakefront, the neighborhoods. I mean, I've run several marathons around the United States and internationally as well. And I tell you what, nothing matches Chicago. Not the beauty of Chicago, but I tell you what, the spectators. This is one of the things that when we talk to our individually folks from the Chicagoland area and saying, why wouldn't you want to run Chicago? After they kind of look at us and say, you're nuts for even asking me to run a marathon. But once we've gotten past that, we just talk about, it's over 1 million spectators. And you just feel such incredible support and camaraderie from people that are on the course. People that are handing you little donuts or little sandwiches or little Snicker bars, and all of a sudden you're kind of going, man, we do have the greatest city in the world. And you feel it. You feel the love of Chicago when you run it. And it's one of the distinctive factors, that we're pretty charged about.
It's one of the appealing things. That's what brings so many people from so many countries and all 50 states to Chicago. It is, and we use it as well, it's the spectator support. 1,700,000 people on the course cheering you on. A lot of our runners, we have duct tape that morning, so white duct tape, you put your name on your shirt, okay? Charles, and they're yelling, Charles, you're looking great. And there was a year I wasn't looking great, I'll tell you. You just take that duct tape off and you're a nonsense man.
Excellent.
But it is the spectator support. It's also the volunteers. What makes this race, I think, stand out in so many minds is how well it's managed. And it's a compliment to Kerry and his team and the volunteer staff that you recruit. It is a flawless event from a participant standpoint, the partnership with Chicago Transit. You can get around as a spectator from one place on the course to another. There's a spectator guide. You can link into CTA and get anywhere on the course as a spectator. So.
Great. And before you answer, Kerry, maybe you could meld this question into your response. It's from our own Skinny Sheehan. By the way, he's running in his 48th marathon. What's the greatest number of marathons that anyone has run in? Has someone run in every Chicago marathon?
We have seven gentlemen from the Chicagoland area that have started and finished all 39 marathons, if you can believe that. So the number has gone down a little bit, but they will be all seven towing the line Sunday, October 9th.
Great.
So we got seven individuals.
Skinny's question is, how many volunteers do you use annually, and what's the secret of recruitment?
For us, we'll use over 12,000 volunteers that support the marathon. And they're in different areas, the aid stations, obviously the water stations that everyone's familiar with, our course marshals, individuals that support and process our participants at the expo. Our medical team, Dr. Champus, I talked to our medical director yesterday, has over 2,000 medical professionals from around the Chicagoland area that are participating. It's part of the team. In many cases, a lot of these individuals have been helping out for 15, 20, and some of them from the beginning. So the event has grown with them. They have contributed. It's a big team effort. They feel they're part of a team, and that's what continues to keep the response and how hard they work and how dedicated they are.
Great. There's a question here from Kay Golden. Kay, where are you? Right back there. She wants to know, who is the top female runner and who is the top male runner?
For this year, our defending champion, who you saw in the finish, that Florence Kiplagat is back. She was very excited, a lot of energy, Charles. You see at the end, she was jumping around, but it was a big win for her. She's returning. Also, the young lady from Ethiopia, Seda Baeza, she won the Boston Marathon this past. She is a former Chicago champion. She'll be here. Our defending champion, Dixon Chumba, who won last year, is back. So those would be our top. I'm excited about a couple of American kids. If anyone that watched the race last year, you saw the tall guy, Luke Pesquedra, who finished fifth. He went with the lead group. He's easy to see. He's 6'4.5". Sergei Kabeta, who is returning, he's an Olympic bronze medalist, is 5'3.5". So you can see the disparity. He's in very good shape. He'll be back. And a young man, who else is up there? Stephen Sambu, a young man, if you've run the shuffle, the young man that won the shuffle a couple of times, phenomenally talented. I think you'd look for one of those individuals to be in the front.
Folks, thank you for coming. Let's give them a big round of applause.